just as Sunday services ended.
President Trump has signed a proclamation implementing travel restrictions on 8 countries. Some of the affected countries include North Korea now and Venezuela, as well as 6 others across the Middle East and Africa.
2 possible blows to the Graham Cassidy health care bill coming from Senator Ted Cruz in Texas and Maine Senator Susan Collins.
Right now, they don't have my vote, and I don't think they have Mike Lee's either.
Our country waking up more divided than ever. More than 200 NFL players took a knee or raised their fist during our national anthem.
Yeah, the protest in response to President Trump calling for coaches to punish players who refuse to stand for the American flag.
This has nothing to do with race. This has to do with respect for our country and respect for our flag.
The protest is-
Former Army Ranger Alejandro Villanueva was the only Pittsburgh Steeler to come out of the locker room before their game against the Chicago Bears.
On a beautiful Monday here in New York City. Thank you for joining us. You're watching the world's number one cable morning news show. Thanks to folks like you.
Yes, thank you. I hope you had a great weekend. Did you guys?
It was very interesting. Of course, the president's remarks on Friday led to a very interesting weekend as we talk about what happened in the NFL as well as with North Korea and what's going on. I'm constantly amazed at the velocity of stories and intensity of news every single day. We have not had one day where you thought to yourself, let's just review. It's always, oh my goodness, look where we're headed.
And you know why that's great? Because we're a news channel. And we've got it all here this morning. Thank you very much for joining us.
There was also, we talked about that church shooting. Remember, what was it, 2 years ago in Charleston? Well, there was another one over the weekend, straight to this Fox News alert. The FBI launching a civil rights investigation into a deadly church shooting in Tennessee.
The masked gunman, an immigrant now, we're learning, from the country of Sudan, opened fire just as the service stopped him.
And when this happened, Jillian Milley went quickly down there to Tennessee, Antioch, Tennessee. Hey, Jillian.
Hey, guys, that's right. Good morning. We landed in Nashville about 9 o'clock local time last night. And once we got off the plane, we immediately came here to the church, the Burnett Chapel Church, where this happened yesterday morning around 11 a.m. And police were still out here last night when we got here, wrapping up their investigation on scene. Actually, just as we pulled up, they were towing away the gunman's vehicle. Police told us that was his vehicle. So they were getting that out of here and getting ready to open up the scene once again, which, by the way, is open this morning. But if you take a look at some video from yesterday when this all happened, when 39-year-old Melanie Smith was shot and killed around 11 o'clock yesterday morning, just as she left church services, 6 others were injured inside the church. I want to tell you what we know about the shooter right now. His name is Emmanuel Samson. He is a 25-year-old. As you guys mentioned, he's a legal U.S. resident, but we learned that he did move here from Sudan in 1996. Now, parishioners from this church, we actually talked to one last night, she told us that he used to come to services here years ago, but that people haven't seen him in a while, and they say they certainly didn't recognize him yesterday since he was wearing a mask. Right now, he is in police custody and is charged with murder. Out of this tragedy, we are already hearing stories of heroism. 2 people, to be exact. Number one, the pastor, the woman we were talking to last night on the scene. She was in the church when this happened. She told me that the pastor saved her life. She said once the gunman came into the church, the pastor shouted, "Run, everybody, get out of here." He yelled just to make sure everybody knew what was going on, try and clear as many people out as possible. The other hero that everyone is talking about this morning is a 22-year-old. He is an usher at the church. His name is Robert Engel. Here's what we're told happened. He got into an altercation inside the church with the gunman. Somehow during that altercation, the gunman was shot. Robert Engel actually ran out of the church into the parking lot to his car, where he had a gun in his car. He came back and held that gunman at gunpoint until police got to the scene. People crediting those 2 men for saving their lives, and a 10-year-old boy could not contain his emotions. Watch.
Just heard like 3 gunshots, and the little girl shut the door, and I heard somebody say, "Get down." When I realized they were alive, I just started like pouring out crying. And that's like, I know I'm 10, and I'm supposed to be tough, but I just couldn't hold in.
Tough to hear from such a young person who witnessed this tragedy. By the way, the FBI has opened a civil rights investigation. Guys.
All right, Jillian, we thank you very much. It was Friday night. If you were watching the channel, you saw the President of the United States. He was down in Alabama for a rally for Luther Strange. There's a special election tomorrow. He's standing off against Judge Moore, and it's really close. Anyway, the President of the United States, in a wide-ranging chat, at one point said, you know, if any NFL player takes a knee during the national anthem, they should get that blank off the field right now. Well, that's when it really started to hit the fan. And the next morning, the president was on Twitter all day long defending his stand that to be patriotic in this country, you should stand up during the national anthem.
Well, yesterday I got a news alert on my phone saying Ravens Jaguars game has begun. It was over in London. That was the first game yesterday, and said that the team took a knee, as you can see, hands on their heart, all in solidarity, just protesting this president.
But then they stood
during God Save the Queen and their national anthem. There's and then you had protesters, different people singing the national anthem. A couple took knees, which is unbelievable. If you have to take a knee during the national anthem, just pass to the next person. But no question. I think personally, I've been out front saying how outrageous I think taking a knee during the national anthem from Colin Kaepernick in there. As you guys know, from day one, because even if you're outspoken in sports, it's no problem. Muhammad Ali, outspoken. Charles Barkley, outspoken. Curt Schilling, outspoken. No one has any problem with, they have an opinion, but they don't have a problem with people speaking out. In fact, a lot of times, they get broadcasting contracts. Like Richard Sherman, when he talked about mediocre, he's going to get the biggest broadcasting contract when he's done playing for the Seahawks.
But you're saying there's a time and a place?
But with the president, and I understand his sentiment, made things so much worse, and the language he used was terrible. When you have Robert Kraft coming out against you, you know you've gone too far. Robert Kraft spends time in the Lincoln bedroom. He's friends with President Trump beyond their wealth and their riches and their circles. He made things immeasurably worse by speaking out. And I know what his intention was, but the language used was galvanizing the wrong direction.
Well, Brian, he is the voice for a lot of people out there. A lot of people agree with him and are scared to give their opinions. I'm not saying I agree with what he's saying. I'm just saying there are a handful of people out there, Brian, that really feel like he's their voice.
But do you think he said that? You think it was appropriate?
Clearly what the president did was, and I've read this on an op-ed page, it said President Trump has taken the side of the flag and the anthem and has provoked millionaire athletes to oppose the symbols of patriotism, like the national anthem. Yesterday, the president, en route to Washington after a weekend in New Jersey and before that in Alabama, he made it very clear out at the airport, spoke to the White House poolers, said this is not about race. This is about patriotism. Watch this.
I think it's very disrespectful to our flag and to our country. So I certainly think the owners should do something about it. There was great solidarity. I watched a little bit, and I will say that there was tremendous solidarity for our flag and for our country. I think it's very disrespectful to our country. I think it's very, very disrespectful to our flag. We have a great country. We have great people representing our country, especially our soldiers, our first responders, and they should be treated with respect. And when you get on your knee, and you don't respect the American flag or the anthem, that's not being treated with respect. This has nothing to do with race. I've never said anything about race. This has nothing to do with race or anything else. This has to do with respect for our country and respect for our flag.
And I know everyone's bringing up that race because the NFL is 70% black. And then the same show, he also, the next day, he brought up the fact that Steph Curry's not coming here. Was thinking about not going to the White House, or wasn't going to the White House. So he says the invitation's rescinded. So that made things worse. People say, well, the NBA is 80% black and the NFL is 70% black. I guess it's about race. But anyone who knows this president knows he's not about race. However, the perception was let out there because it wasn't pre-thought how he was saying it. The other thing is about the NFL. My goodness, for 9/11, people wore symbols on their red, white, and blue on their cleats, and they got fined or they got threatened to be fined. You can't wear something across your headband that the NBA, the NFL doesn't sanction. I am shocked over a year later they have not addressed this with the players' union, so it didn't even get to this point.
It's just sad when these guys are millionaires and they're protesting the president in this way. This is the red, white, and blue. This is America. I wish they would find find a different way to protest. I'm glad that it's not violent. I'm glad that it's peaceful. I understand that our men and women who fought for this great country and fought for the flag did it so that they have the right to do that. But we're asking men and women who are paid $20,000 a year to go over to different countries and sacrifice their lives so that we can enjoy football, so we can spend our Sundays at these football games. And I guarantee we're going to see people give up their season tickets.
Well, we'll see. There was a lot of booing when a lot of the players did take a knee during the anthem yesterday.
In Buffalo and New England.
In a number of different cities. But there was one, and apparently the Steelers decided what they would do is the team would stay in the locker room for the national anthem. That way they wouldn't get booed, and that they way officially they wouldn't have a picture of everybody taking a knee if that was the case. However, that was not what 28-year-old former Army Ranger Alejandro Villanueva did. He became an instant hero. He was the only Steeler to actually come out of the tunnel and stand in that area between the tunnel and also the field. If you missed it, here he is, and you can hear the anthem in the background.
Mike Tomlin
became a hero to the people who think that the players should stand for the national anthem. Go ahead.
Right. And Mike, by the way, he had three tours in Afghanistan. He's coming out of the locker room, believe me. Mike Tomlin says, I want the team to stay together. I'm disappointed the whole team didn't stay together.
That's the coach of the Steelers.
I cannot believe that he actually weighed in on this. Listen.
We're not going to let divisive times or divisive individuals affect our agenda. We're not going to play politics with football players, with football coaches. We're not participating in the anthem today. Not to be disrespectful to the anthem, to remove ourselves from this circumstance.
By the way, that former Army Ranger, his jersey rocketed to the top five of all jerseys sold in America yesterday.
Great. He played at the military academy, and he won the Bronze Star Medal of Valor. He's an offensive tackle for the
Steelers.
And now
it's spread to baseball. Bruce Maxwell, catcher with the A's, took a knee. The L.A. Sparks, the WNBA, are in the finals. They refused to come out of the locker room during the game. And probably the worst display I've seen is LeSean McCoy of the Buffalo Bills stretched the entire time the national anthem was taking place.
So whose side do you come down on, the president or the protesters? Email us, friends at foxnews.com. You can tweet us or Facebook. Meanwhile, coming up on this Monday, ISIS has a new target, Prince Harry. The disturbing message from that terror group coming up.
And our next guest knows a little something about sacrifice. He has a message for those anthem protesters. Johnny Joey Jones lost both of his legs in Afghanistan, and you won't want to miss what he has to say. All right, here we go. During Football Sunday yesterday, a day that's supposed to be about football, instead became about politics. NFL players and some team owners joining a national anthem protest. Some took a knee, others sat, others stretched, some locked arms and even skipped the anthem altogether. So what is it about sacrifice that some athletes feel as though the best way to show it is to take a knee or not participate? Let's bring in Johnny Joey Jones, who spent last Monday, who lost both his legs, by the way, while he was trying to defuse a bomb in Afghanistan. But you spent last week with the Cincinnati Bengals, not knowing the president was going to say what he said. What was your message to them?
Well, you know, over a year ago, I tweeted Colin Kaepernick and said, listen, I don't have legs, but I'll stand with enough pride for both of us when they play our national anthem. And that didn't go away. It went viral. So when I went up to Cincinnati to work with the Bengals on teamwork and leadership and brotherhood last Monday, that was the first thing I addressed with them. And I said, you know, quite frankly, you know, if you're in this room and you took a knee, I love you. I love you because I share this country with you, and the purest form of patriotism is to love the strangers you see on the street just because we share this country together. And someone from the back said, no one on this team is taking a knee. And that meant a lot to me. That showed me that they really heard what I was saying, and they understand the true meaning of the flag, the national anthem, and everything else this country stands for. You know, they took it to overtime last night, and they'll get the next one.
Right. And, you know, they did have their best game of the year last night, even though they fell short. But then you're going to be speaking again to the Ravens this week. What's your message to the Ravens after they go over to Wembley, took a knee, and got crushed?
Same thing. Listen, I would stand in front of every man kneeling on the NFL and give that man a hug and ask that man to stand with me and stand for me, because I will stand for him. I'll stand for what he cares about, but more importantly, I'll stand for the fact that this country is a place you can protest, and that's all the reason you need to take a stand and respect this country.
Am I right, Johnny, that one of the things is protests, but the thing that makes it different is it's about the flag and the anthem? It's like protesting your own family instead of going inside and making it better.
You know, the way I look at it, I don't know what it's like to be a 25-year-old black man on the streets of any city in this country and be discriminated against. But no one in the NFL other than Alejandro Villanueva really knows what it's like to be a 25-year-old American in the middle of a country where everyone wants to kill you. So we all have things to learn from each other. We all need to hear each other out.
Right.
Most importantly, we all need to try and love each other, and we need to stand together. There were a few teams yesterday that locked arms and stood in unison, and that's what we need to talk about.
And Johnny, lastly, you understand the president's sentiment, obviously. That's what you're speaking about, but you didn't like the language.
No, listen, I don't call names to the Taliban that took my legs. They don't deserve that from me, and the honor I learned in the Marine Corps keeps me above that. Everyone I think I don't like, I may